I'm Ernest Camel Mead, Jr., with the nickname Boots. I was born in 1918, which is practically a century ago.
When Thomas Jefferson laid out his architectural plan for the University of Virginia, interspersing student rooms between faculty homes and directing that classes be taught in faculty living rooms, he was also laying the foundations for a unique student-faculty relationship. In the decades that followed, no teacher at the university has embodied that tradition more wholly than Ernest Mead. A man adored by one generation of students after another, a man who radiates love and wisdom, not only in the way he speaks, but in the way he listens. This is Boots.
I was a Depression kid, and so I went to public school, and then I came to the University of Virginia. I wanted to find out something here at the university, but things other than music.
Mr. Mead graduated from the university in 1940. He played piano professionally for several years before continuing his studies at Harvard. In 1951, he returned to Virginia with his wife, Sally, and began teaching, eventually becoming chairman of the music department.
A group of students, they were very outstanding students at the university. They were rising fourth year, we call it. They were third year students. Invited my wife and me out in the country on a May afternoon. It was a beautiful May day. Finally, they turned to me and said, "Mr. Mead, in our last year, in our fourth year, we'd like to get together in a small group and discuss things that we are particularly interested in without the strictures of exams, quizzes, syllabus, that sort of thing. Would you do it?" And I said, "Yes, I'll do it. Then they'd forget about it that night. But they didn't. They came to me in the fall and said, quite frankly, "You said you'd do it, now here we are." I've been teaching the seminars since 1970, and it's interesting to remember that the students started that. The seminar has been very revealing to me and very stimulating to me, because increasingly they become more open and more frank in expressing their reactions. Consequently, with that attitude on the part of the students, I am able to stimulate further this imagination of the students.
It's honestly people's songs.
At the very beginning, students are asked to submit a list of no more than five topics or questions, subjects that are of interest to them. These can be from current society or the arts, or it can be from some historical period.
The seminar's been fantastic. We've had great, great conversations. There's nine of us in a small class that meets in the Colonnade Club once a week. We meet for 2.5 hours and discuss really anything that we feel is interesting to us and that we want to learn and talk about and discuss in a sort of Socratic dialogue.
Works from a political and a social standpoint a lot better from both taking classes but also speaking to friends who are from developing parts of the world. And I understand issues of race a lot better from being...
The subject matter is motivated by the students. I act as a guide, a counselor, sometimes a disciplinarian, but as one of the students, really.
I don't think that you're learning as much.
Students' interest...
To become intelligently informed. They can't be authorities on all subjects. But I point out to them that after they graduate, they are citizens. And they are responsible for everything. Not only is it an interesting intellectual experience for them, but it encourages them to be venturesome. You might say to go into the wild occasionally, go out on a branch, even though it might fall. But in their thinking, to be venturesome, to look beyond the Blue Ridge here into what's on the other side.
His magic really lies within his connection with students. He really, really stresses wanting to know different points of views. Even if he might not agree with them, he really makes sure that he understands where you're coming from. And that's something that often we don't get to have with professors. We don't get to have that moment of like, well, this is how I feel. Professors are usually like, well, this is how it is.
He goes deeper than I think most people do in just sort of standard conversation where you know, at university you're so often just doing the name, hometown, major. And he'll really get in and sort of ask you how that sort of thing sort of affects how you enjoy UVA and, you know, why is it that you want to go to this country to study abroad. On the other hand, talking with him, there's also a sense of intellectual curiosity that I think is very inspiring to most students.
He's really defined what I think UVA cherishes about their professors and student relationships, which is he cares about what the students are saying, he cares about what they're thinking, but he also challenges you in what you're thinking.
I'm going to leave this university on fire for knowledge, and I truly believe that Mr. Mead has had a large impact on me in that capacity, and that the way he teaches our class is a method by which he encourages us to pursue the topic how we decide to pursue it. He has no agenda. He just wants us to learn. He wants us to increase our understanding of truth and knowledge.
O Lord of grace, love, and compassion, the source of food for all life, bless this food to our use and ourselves to your service, and keep us ever mindful of the needs of others. Amen. Well, there's no getting around the fact the age-old tradition of breaking bread together does tend to facilitate conversation and loosen up rapport. I'm simply carrying on the relationship on the lawn in students having classes and meeting in pavilions, and Jefferson's having students at Monticello.
The idea, I think, to a lot of my peers that I would have dinner at a professor's house is just unthinkable. And here, it's not even something that the students necessarily have to seek out. The faculty, Mr. Mead being the prime example, really are committed to this idea that learning is to take place just as much outside of the classroom as inside of it, and that the class experience should continue after lecture ends.
I would take a group of first-year students. It's usually a small group, 15 or 20 or something, first-year students, over to Old Cabell Hall on the lawn, at the foot of the lawn.
And he recited the words at the top of Old Cabell Hall.
Kai gnosis et tena letheon, kai hea letheon letherose humus. And then I added, and don't you ever forget it. Well, of course, at this point, the students were, what was going on?
And then he translated.
And ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. And then eventually they would realize that my office was right under the word aletheon, which is truth in that inscription. And ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. My office is right there, so I'd say I'm under the truth.
Leaving the lingering question in the mind that that's what you're here for, find it.
Seek it. Seek the truth. This is a very remarkable book. It was assembled by two students of mine several years ago, and it contains letters from former students and friends. Dear Mr. Mead, as I sit down to write this letter, I am finding that trying to describe the impact.
Dear Mr. Mead, I locate my most memorable academic experience at Virginia right in your office at the end of the lawn where I participated in your seminar class.
Dear Mr. Mead,
where else was I?
I realize just saying thank you is insufficient for all that you've given me and all that.
You are a teacher in the finest sense of the word. You haven't just taught your students to be better scholars.
You have challenged and encouraged me and taught me so
much.
That was
the first of many walks and talks around the lawn.
I have spent a lot of quality time with you in your house.
You invited me to join you for tea at the faculty dining
room. You realized that life is truly worth living to the fullest.
You always created a safe and comfortable place for us to just sit and talk.
or walk and talk.
I'm grateful for the relationships I've made at this university, both with faculty and with other students. I think those are the things that will endure after I leave.
I'm grateful for the fact that Mr. Mead continues to come back to the university year after year and share his stories with us and hear about our stories as well.
I had a lot of blessings here at UVA, but I realized that one of the things that I'm going to miss most is my relationship with Mr. Mead.
Boots has given me the gift of seeing the best relationship that you could really have with a professor, the most personal and the most exciting and close connection that you could have with a professor.
Grateful for what students have taught me. At my age, I look back on a great deal that has happened. I realize that in my youth and first part of my life, that I was very concerned with my ideas, what I wanted to get done, that gradually this contact with students has opened up a whole new identity for me, a more important mission for me, and one that I've come to quite spontaneously and quite naturally, is one of liberating the students in their thinking, in their aspirations, in their personality, in their honesty with themselves, in their identity. I feel, quite frankly, that I'm an instrument. I take no credit for any of it. I've found that I can help to liberate a student here and there, and that, I find, is the important thing. And that's what really motivates by continuing to teach. Stands out on either side, no wider than the heart is wide. Above the world is stretched the sky, no higher than the soul is high.